In a few hours, I'll start the journey from here back home, and that's as much as I travel. So I'll try to show you today is how we implement the methodology that Tom mentioned that of experimental evolution, how we try to bring in evolution into the lab, and what are the advantages and what questions you can start asking while you when you import evolution to the lab. We have fancy robotic systems that allows us to carry out very, very simple evolutionary experiments. The experiments are simple in concept, and indeed Richard Lenski was the one that made them first so effective and famous. The idea is you take, so we don't evolve giraffes or elephants in the lab, just microorganisms. We do evolve human cells in the context of cell lines, and then the methodology with some obvious modifications applies almost as is. But in bacteria and in yeast, as I'll show you today, you inoculate a given amount of cells in a test tube. The typical number is about 1 million at the beginning of a day. You let them grow for 24 hours. The medium is such that in 24 hours, they will achieve about 7 doublings. So you'll get 128 million cells at the end of that day. And in order to keep constant population with fluctuations, you would sample a volume that is 1/128 of the volume and hence of the cells, and you will inoculate them in a fresh medium and you'll repeat that process again and again. And the idea is that if certain cells had a mutation or some other genetic or epigenetic event, or maybe you have started in the beginning with some diversity that was sourced outside, if certain cells have a higher fitness nonetheless, they have a higher chance to be sampled by your pipette, and hence you're selecting for the faster growth cells. That's as simple as that. And we have automation of this process. We can do it in parallel in many different volumes, many different cell numbers, many different genetic backgrounds, treat them differently, et cetera, et cetera. But the basic idea is extremely simple. And the advantages of lab evolution, experimental evolution, relative to the observer's type of approach to evolution, which doesn't need my praising, of course, extremely important for its own sake, but the advantages of the lab evolution approach is that it allows you to really measure things such as mutation rate, transposition rate, as was so nicely shown here in very clean session. You can do evolutionary experiments with control. It is a basic tenet of experimental science that you need to have a control. I'll show you how we can control for various types of factors in our environments. When Darwin went to Galapagos, he didn't have another Galapagos with a control in which everything else is identical except for the temperature or something. You can do evolutionary experiments with repetitions. Again, Darwin didn't have several Galapagos to ask what happens if he visits in each one of them. We have. Each test tube can be a repetition of another, and we do those experiments in many, many, many repetitions. And it allows to start asking questions such as how reproducible, for instance, is a solution that you saw. How ragged is the landscape, and perhaps how stochastic is the search to optimize this landscape, et cetera, et cetera. We can let, as I'll show briefly, let theory guide experiments. We can watch a whole movie, not just to take a snapshot at the beginning or the end of a process, as for instance was done in Galapagos. You can actually watch the whole movie, and evolution is a dynamic process, so we can reveal all the intermediates. We can start, as I'll show you today, reveal what's interesting about intermediates, what is the nature of going through intermediates towards an improved solution, et cetera, et cetera. We can have an exact knowledge and even control on the experimental conditions, on the environmental conditions, if you will. Darwin, at most, could infer what were the conditions in Galapagos in the last millions of years, at most. And even if he could, of course, he couldn't control them. We can control them, we determine them. In fact, we can actually set them such that they will challenge the cells as they evolve and maybe even always keep them on the tip of their toes, because as they approach and progress on their learning curve, we can make the conditions more challenging or just change them, et cetera, et cetera. So it's a very rich paradigm that is, it's a lot of fun to play with in the lab. So I want to show you two studies that were published that I think show the beauty of this experimental evolution approach, and then show you on a relatively briefly two studies that are ongoing in the lab, and end with a crazy idea for a new study that we are beginning to develop. So you can imagine now an organism in its natural habitat. And that organism lives in that environment, and this is an axis that shows the progression of time. And it is encountered by different stimuli or stresses or signals such as S1 and S2, et cetera, et cetera. And this is one type of an environment, and this is another environment. And the two environments show the same two signals, S1 and S2, roughly with the same temporal density, et cetera, et cetera. But one of those environments offers the organism with an opportunity that the other one perhaps does not offer. In both cases, we assume that the organism has a response mechanism designated for S1 and another response mechanism designated for S2, and it, upon sensing of S1 and S2, will respond. But one of those environments offers an opportunity that the other one doesn't. Can anyone spot it very quickly? In the second environment, S1 and S2 are together, and not only that they are together, in fact, the rule is that S1 precedes S2, right? It's not that S1 is always preceded by S2. It's not that S2 could not appear in the second environment without the prior appearance of S1, but there are enough, quote unquote, and we'll try to make it quantitative, there are enough perhaps events in which S1 could actually have served as a predictor for the arrival of S2. So the question is, would an organism catch that idea as quickly, or perhaps not as quickly as you caught it, and develop a mechanism to take advantage of that? Okay? So with some basic notation, in a direct regulation scheme, each response is responsive only to its own designated signal, the signal with which it is meant to directly or evolve to directly cope. But in more complex regulatory schemes that, for instance, could evolve in the second environment, S1 would activate also in advance R2 before actually S2 is being encountered. And if there is some asymmetry in the environment such that S1 is a predictor of S2, but S2 is not a predictor of S1, we might not expect an edge going in the opposite direction, but in less structured and perhaps more symmetric environments, it actually might be the case that both of them would activate each other's responses. Okay? So we decided to focus on this particular type of association, this case in which there is also asymmetry in the environment, and it reminded us of the Pavlovian paradigm from the cognitive context, in which you ring a bell for your dog and then you give it a meat, and then the dog, if you repeat it enough times, the dog will learn to associate between the bell and the meat, and it will salivate in response to the bell. We coined this potential scheme of regulation conditioned regulation. Okay, in analogy to classical conditioning in psychology and in neuroscience. And it is reminiscent, although different, from associative learning, in which each one of them can... So the dog doesn't prepare for the bell when it sees the meat, but it definitely prepares for the meat when it sees the bell. Yes? It's inherited or... Oh, okay. So are you asking whether the development or evolution, perhaps, of this is something that occurs, like in the case of a dog, during the lifetime of a single individual dog? Or is it a process when applied, for instance, to microorganisms, and in changing environment that takes evolutionary time to evolve? That's a very good question, and let me make the distinction right at the beginning. We are talking more about the second than about the first. So here is where the analogy to the cognitive neural case, et cetera, might end. It will come back again in a few minutes later on, but in a different embodiment. But by and large, we are interested in evolutionary conditioning, not behavioral conditioning, not neuronal-based, of course, conditioning. But this does not exclude the possibility that perhaps even something that is more reminiscent of the cognitive concept could occur in cells. I don't think that at the moment we know how to detect it if it occurs. Okay, but we are still borrowing the analogy, and as I'll try to convince you, borrowing the analogy was very, very helpful, very fruitful, because it let us think about the next experiments by taking the analogy. But it's a very, very good point, yes. So it was Amir Mitchell, who was a PhD student in my lab, and now is a postdoc at UCSF, that first came up with this idea. And I immediately recognized this is a wonderful idea, and the question was, what do we do with it? And we decided to do three things. One is to try to see if contemporary organisms may have already evolved such evolutionarily such conditioning-like capacities. And all we need to do is to understand how they do that, et cetera, et cetera. The second is that we want to model it mathematically in order to appreciate when would natural evolution select for a conditioning capacity. It seems superficially that it might always be beneficial to predict the future and to prepare for it in advance. But it does not necessarily have to be the case always, because maybe the environment is not very predictable. Maybe the environment will give you many false alarms. Maybe there's going to be many S1s that are not preceded by S2. Maybe the cost of preparing for S2 when S1 arrived is too large compared to the benefit that you gain from being prepared to S2 when S2 arrives. Maybe your response time to S2 is so quick that you actually don't need a preparation in advance. When S2 arrives, you build up your R2 response and you're ready. So we wanted to understand in what subspace of all those parameters it would be beneficial for the organism to prepare in advance. And the third thing that we wanted to do is to try to see if within the lab we can change or evolve. And again, it will be analogous to the Pavlovian teaching only by analogy, because everything will be acquired evolutionarily. It will take hundreds of generations. So we thought and actually verified. But can we do interesting experimental evolution to change the conditioning wiring diagram according to conditions that we impose? Okay. So let's walk through each of those stages. This is a human body. And what lives in our body is, as you know, a huge collection of microbes, the microbiome. And we typically get many of them up in the diet, and E. coli is one of them. So we eat E. coli, and then it goes through the digestive tract, and it either stays for a while, or it's being deposited on the ground, in which case it will be eaten by another animal, maybe a human, maybe something else, and it will rotate body, ground, body, ground, body, ground. And that is by itself some regularity that the organism may have evolved to capture. But even within the system, within the body, there is a succession of environmental changes that the organism experiences. So perhaps there was an opportunity for it not only to deal with each of those conditions in isolation, but in fact in the context, the temporal context, and the spatial context in which they occur. And in particular, if you follow E. coli when you eat it up, the first thing that it would probably, in most locations on Earth, experience is an increase in the temperature to 37 degrees. Okay, maybe it lived at 20 outside, maybe it was 37. But typically, there's going to be a shift up in the temperature. There's going to be a change in the partial pressure of oxygen, typically lower. And then it will start to go down. And here in the stomach, it will hit a low pH stress. And then it will start to go through the intestine. and it will consume food, and it turns out, and of several additional changes that it will acquire. Of course, when it will be deposited on the ground, the first thing I think that it will experience is a UV radiation stress, et cetera, et cetera. We decided to focus metabolically on two changes that it could sense because it turned out it was already noticed many years ago that in a more proximal region of the intestine, the main carbon source is going to be lactose, and in a more distal one, maltose is going to be the main carbon source, the main sugar that it will consume. So the question was whether E. coli has evolved to use lactose not only as a source of food, as a fuel molecule, but as a signal that prepares the maltose metabolizing genes and the maltose degradation in general in order for it to be prepared when it comes typically several hours later on to the maltose meal after the lactose. So the first thing that we wanted to see is if there is any transcription-based evidence or transcription-level evidence for such a conditioned response. And to see in particular whether it shows the asymmetry that is expected from the fact that they typically go in one direction down the tract and not in the opposite direction. So we decided to look at the transcriptional activity of the promoters of the lactose metabolizing genes. And there was one such promoter, as you probably know. For maltose, there is no less than five different promoters, five different operons. So we looked at each of them. We fused GFP to each of those promoters to measure just promoter activity of those promoters when the cells are either treated with lactose or with maltose or as a control just with the medium. Okay. So let's first focus on lactose. What is the lactose promoter activity when the cells are encountered with lactose or with maltose? Lactose is, of course, high response, and we define it to be the 100%. No response is when you treat the cells with nothing. It's the yellow diamond here. And they do not respond at all to maltose. Okay? As much as, you know, yeah. Okay. If we look at the maltose genes, of course, they each respond to maltose, and we define the level of response for each of them to maltose to be our 100%. They do have some background fluorescence activity that is different for each of them, and this is why it's good to have a calibration for the autofluorescence and the leakiness, perhaps, of each of those promoters individually. But when we triggered the cells with maltose, we saw that each of the maltose promoters does show some residual response. It's not as high as maltose, so the arrow that connects between lactose and the maltose genes is thinner than the arrow that connects between lactose and lactose genes or maltose and the maltose genes, but it exists nonetheless. Okay? So it seems as if the cells are kind of putting one foot in the water to see how it feels immediately when lactose comes, and perhaps they wait for further development. Yes. The green bar, the green. Are you asking whether it's interesting that here the gap between the red and the green is small compared to the gap here?
Not about the gap, but the extent of activity.
Oh, and let me see if I understand. Are you asking whether, given the activity of MAL-E in particular, can we rationalize the partial response here given the function of MAL-E or the function of MAL-K, et cetera, et cetera? Okay, that's a good question. We tried. We know the function of each of them, and I can't say anything too interesting about it. I don't think we understand exactly how to rationalize the variations given the function of those genes. That's right. That's right. It's a good observation. Yes. Yes.
And in case of non-biologists,
In case of?
No.
Glycerol. Glycerol. Yeah. Okay, so they appear to do something. Does it pay off if we trigger them with lactose before we give them a meal of maltose? So here is this regime. We give them lactose, and 3 hours later, we give them maltose. And we compare the growth rate to the growth rate that they show if we give them the two sugars exactly at the same concentrations, but at the same time. Okay? So the value of one is always if we give the two sugars together. And if there is a value here above one, that means of 3% above one in growth rate, that means that when giving the two sugars with a separation of 3 hours gives rise to a growth on maltose that is 3% larger in terms of growth rate compared to the growth rate that they show if we give the two sugars simultaneously. And of course, 3% in growth rate, you know, it's an appreciable effect because it's the exponential, the exponent term. If we reverse the order of things, we give them maltose and then lactose, 3 hours later maltose, and compare that to maltose and lactose at the same time, they don't show an improvement, if anything, slightly less, but I suspect that it should be quite close to the one line. That's my guess. If we trigger them with maltose and first give them other sugars, they don't appear to do the game. So that was interesting. And then we said maybe it's due to some internal metabolic considerations that they are hardwiring the activity of the maltose and the lactose genes in the way they are. And it doesn't really prove that they have evolved to that response because they saw in their environment an association between lactose and maltose in this particular order. Question? We'll get to that in a second. It's the most interesting one. Yes? In the dioxic, you know, I'm not sure. I don't know. Of course, each of them would be used after glucose. Yeah. And it's a good question, and I regret to say that we haven't bothered to measure it. It was measured by Uri alone in a nice paper from, I guess, 2008 or so. He measured the pairwise priority relationships between many of those sugars, including these two, but I actually don't remember which one is consumed first. It's a very good question. It's five promoters, each of which is driving several genes. But we are measuring just the promoter activity. Yes, it's amazing. And five operons and obviously more than five genes. Yes. It's interesting. I don't want to be carried away too much, although it's extremely interesting, mainly because I don't know the answer. But I do want to say that I'm more surprised that all three LAC operons are in one, all three LAC genes are in one operon. If I were to design their genome, I would have done it differently, and I can tell you later on why. So I'm more surprised that in the lactose it's all in one operon and the one promoter than in the opposite. But allow me, please, to not to go too much into it, because I don't have a good answer to that. So how useful was the analogy to the Pavlovian paradigm? Indeed, as you suggested, it is different. But we did realize that after Pavlov trained his dog to associate between the bell and the meat, that's the most famous phase of the experiment, he also did another phase in which he rang the bell and gave the dog no meat. And that was the stage of extinction. The dog was not full. He immediately, or it took it a while at least, to realize that the rules of the game have changed, and Bell no meat, bell no meat, bell no meat. He stops salivating for the bell. He keeps salivation for the meat, but not for the bell. So we said, can we evolve ourselves to dissociate or to uncouple between the lactose and maltose response? Of course, that would require evolving them under lactose-only conditions without following maltose, with maltose. Okay? So, in fact, that experiment was done for us. Alon and Dekel have done an experiment for a totally different reason. You know very much this experiment. They grew E. coli for many generations, 500 generations, on lactose only, without giving them maltose. Of course, who would give them maltose just like that? And we could look at those cells and ask what happens to them. So first at the transcription level, the next slide would be the physiology. At the transcription level, this is how the wild type looks. Again, we saw that. The red bars are above the red diamond above the green ones. In the evolved strain, they were perfectly aligned. In at most 500 generations, E. coli was clever enough to understand that we are fooling him in a way, because there's no maltose coming after the lactose meal, and they were able to totally, in all five operons, all five promoters, cut the connection between lactose and maltose. You could ask, and it's in the paper, if they maybe they stopped using the maltose genes, maybe they lost the maltose genes. Maybe they are not functional, maybe they are not responsive also to maltose. They are perfectly responsive to maltose. They can live on maltose, they can grow maltose. Nothing in their maltose response has changed, except for, as far as we could tell, the response of maltose genes to lactose. And you can try to rationalize, it's quite easy, I think, in terms of population genetics, why they were so quick to cut the connection between lactose and the maltose genes, but not as quick at all in cutting the connection between the maltose and the maltose genes. One of them is operating purifying selection, one of them is operating under drift, which is much slower. This happened in three independent repetitions of the same experiment, so we were quite safe in concluding that the association between maltose and lactose that we see in the wild type was probably there not because of some internal constraint that the system, the metabolism cannot do it otherwise, but it was, in a way, environmental condition dependent, and we could very easily find an environmental condition that does not necessitate this association, in fact, probably selects against it. So the last bar that you were asking about is repeating again exactly the same experiment as here, giving them lactose and then maltose, and comparing the growth rate to giving the two sugars together, as opposed to in a time gap of 3 hours, except that if this was done in the wild type, this was done in the evolved cell that, as we saw before, cut the regulatory connection between the two pathways. And indeed, in this cell, giving them first lactose and then maltose does not have the same fitness benefit as we saw in the wild type. Okay, so there was a clear functional correlate to the transcriptional activity change, yes? That's excellent. Okay, can we train them back? So again, we had to look at the Pavlovian books in order to come up with this question, because indeed Pavlov, with his dog, did conditioning, did extinction, and did reinstatement. Reinstatement is the phase in which you reintroduce the connection between the two. Yes? You know, we sequenced the strain. We found a few mutations. They got us close to understanding what happened, but it was not in the CRP, and we couldn't nail it down to a mechanism. Yeah, yeah. I'll show you later on, as time permits, a parallel example in yeast in which we think we understand a little bit more what's the mechanism. We are still struggling with this reinstatement experiment, okay? And another experiment that we are hoping to do in the lab is to do conditioning, but for a totally different pair of conditions. Let's see if we can evolve cells that would I don't know, we'll give them a hint every time before an antibiotic comes, and that hint would be, I don't know, something else. We'll whistle a blow a whistle or something. I don't know what. Let's see if we can do that. Something more realistic, perhaps. We are still struggling with that, but this is at least an agenda that we can play with. Okay. Which time will increase to 1,000? This is an interesting question. It's an interesting assumption. What he's suggesting, remind me your name?
Moshe
is suggesting that perhaps the time that the organism lived on the coupling should be proportional to the time that it takes it in order to generate extinction of the coupling. So if you evolved under the conditioned environment for longer, then it would take longer to do the extinction. And I don't know if you have an interesting prediction about the time it would take to reinstate as a function perhaps of this time or of this time. It's interesting, although I don't know that this is necessarily the case. I don't know that it does not plateau, for instance, very quickly perhaps. It's interesting. And to make it realistic, one needs to, again, find a good example. By the way, I'm not entirely sure that it's only in mammals, but mammal evolution is a very, it's in the hundreds of millions of years. So it's not a very, very short glimpse. Yes. We think it's a genetic change. We see a set of mutations arising in the genome, but we have not been able to nail it down to an exact mechanism. Yes? We are hoping to do the reinstatement. It's an excellent set of questions. We can theorize about it together, philosophize if theory doesn't work. But I don't know the answer to them. When I told you that the response of the maltose genes to lactose is partial, maybe 30% or so, you could have asked me, please specify what you mean, because there could be two extreme ways for this readout to show us a value of 30%. One extreme is that all the cells in the population are activating the maltose genes in response to maltose to 30% of the level that they would activate them in response to maltose. And what's the alternative? I think you know that perhaps 30%, to go to the extreme, 30% of the population are fully responsive, and the rest are ignoring the signal altogether. So the population is kind of playing some bet hedging that is very famous in our type of thinking about biological systems. So we wanted to do an experiment to say which one of them is perhaps the case. And this is, again, not very conclusive, but we looked at the lactose at the maltose genes as they are responding to lactose over a time course of several hours. We looked at them when they were responsive to maltose, again, over several hours. We looked at them when they simply were grown on glycerol, so that is the non-kind of. And it was interesting that when the cells are responding to lactose and we are measuring the maltose genes, they show us a long right tail that suggests that we are not seeing when the same genes are responding to maltose, suggesting perhaps that this partial response could at least in part be mediated as a population split rather than an undecided response in each of the individual cells. But again, this is something that is yet to be pursued further. We also wanted, as I said, to understand more theoretically, taking kind of an economic view on it, what is the set of considerations, quote unquote, that a cell would be undergoing when it quote-unquote decides evolutionarily whether to develop a predictive system or not to. As we said before, there are many parameters that govern that decision, such as, for instance, the reproducibility of the environment. What's the probability that S2 would occur given that S1 occurred within a time gap after the S1 appearance? What is the cost of preparing? What is the response of the speed of the response to S2 if not in preparation? What is the gain, et cetera, et cetera? So we started with a toy model that we actually made at the end very realistic to the point that we could compare it to experimental results. And the idea was that the difference in the fitness, imagine that at the beginning all the population is naive. And none of the cells has the capacity to predict in advance. And then the first, so all of the population is manifesting direct regulation, as we call it. And then the first cell comes in that has a mutation or some epigenetic change, for that matter, that allows it to condition. What is the difference in the fitness between those two cells? Integrated over a long time in that in that environment, in which S1s and S2s are appearing in some order or lack of order, and we want to integrate over a long, long period of time that is pretty much like the first schematic arrow that I showed you at the beginning with S1s and S2s, et cetera, et cetera. And we realized that this difference should be proportional to the difference between two types of terms. The first term is a term that has a P here. P is the probability that S2 would occur given that S1 occurred in some delta T time interval following the onset of S1. So with some probability, you will get S2. And with 1 minus that probability, you will have a false alarm. S2 would not occur at all. And there's going to be some benefit that the cells are going to have in those cases in which it was coupled, but they are also going to pay some cost of preparing. Okay? And in probability 1 minus p, they will only pay the cost. And the cost might be different, as I'll show you in a minute. So of course, the larger the p, the greater is the difference in fitness and the capacity of this environment to select for conditioned responses. And there is a toy model, you can play with it, you can ask what happens as a function of the predictability of the environment, of the cost and the gain, et cetera, et cetera. And you can imagine where within this space would lie the solutions that are a pro-selection. But let me make the model a bit more realistic. Let's say that at a given time point, S1 occurred, and after a delta T time interval, S2 occurred. So here we can actually say that if you are a predictive cell, you would pay a cost, C1, throughout the time period from here to here. If you only want to measure what is the difference in the fitness, you mainly should worry about the cost that you are paying here in this time interval, because from that point on, also the naive cell will start to pay a cost. And the benefit we'll see you are paying if and when S1 appears. So this is another more detailed way to look at that. S1 appears here, S2 appears here, it appears here. And if your response is to be fully conditioned, you'd say treat lactose in the maltose genes, you treat lactose as if you saw maltose. Okay? Then you would immediately mount a response in the maltose genes in R2 in response to S1 as if it was S1. If you are a totally naive cell, you would wait for S2 to occur, in which case you will start to mount your response. And if you are putting some 1 foot in the water and you're intermediate, then there's going to be some intermediate response. And then when S2 appears, you'll commit to it fully. The gain is going to be larger for, of course, for the cells that prepared in advance and lowest for the cells that ignored S1. But the cost, the fully preparing cells will pay a cost that is supposed to be constant due to constant production level throughout that time period, and the intermediate and the ignoring ones are going to be in between or in the other places. What's really important is the difference in the growth rate. So at first, the predictive cells would actually suffer from the activation, and later on they will enjoy it. And a very detailed model that we have developed simply integrates over the costs and the gains from throughout the time period and actually predicts for various parameters what would be the delta fitness between the conditioning and the non-conditioning cells. We have been able to actually play with this model in the lab and with very little fitting actually show that we can indeed predict at what regimes of the parameters this solution is likely to, the conditioning solution is likely to be beneficial to the organism. I won't go into the details. It's all published in two papers that I've shown you here. We then wanted to see if other organisms perhaps manifest that conditioning. So we went into the yeast. Yeast has a totally different lifestyle, life cycle. It has been used by humans, not only mammals, humans, and not since humans appeared on Earth, but in the last 7,000 years, humans have been using yeasts for wine production. They put yeast cells at the bottom of barrels, and then they put in grapes or whatever it is, and or for beer, you know, and yeast start to ferment. And when they undergo this process, fermentation generates a lot of heat. They start to consume the glucose, as was discussed in Heinemann's talk, although in the context of bacteria. And then they undergo the process of dioxic shift. They exhaust the glucose. They start to respire. And with respiration comes also an oxidative stress. Ethanol is being produced that kills them at the end and kills their enemies, by the way, too. Perhaps this is why a main reason for why they produce ethanol. But we decided, and then, of course, at the end of the process, yeast cells are remaining in the bottom of the barrels for another round of this cycle. So if in E. coli we had body ground, here we have this process. So this is the wine process. This is the ecology of wine process making. Again, a very vigorous process, very, very unpleasant. But the question was whether cells have not only evolved means to cope with each of those challenges in isolation, but rather to connect between them, such that early events would perhaps protect them or exposure to them would activate the genes needed for later events and hence provide a protection. I'm not going to show you all the transcription regulatory part. This is all published in Mitchell et al. In Nature in 2009. Okay? I want to show you one interesting result and then move to the next, experiment. We have actually shown, I can't show it to you now, I don't have time, that when you expose yeast to even a mild heat shock, they upregulate the oxidative response genes. If you expose them to oxidative stress, they do not typically activate the heat genes, as much as that maltose did not activate the lactose genes. So asymmetry in the ecology is somehow reflected in asymmetry in the wiring of the regulatory network. What I want to show you is what do they gain from this prior activation of the genes in response to the preceding conditioning stimulus. We can give them such a harsh oxidative stress that only 1% of the population would survive it unless preceded by a very, very mild heat shock. If it is preceded by a mild heat shock, rather than 1% survival, we get 46% survival. So it's a huge cross-protective effect, immunization, if you will. Likewise, we can protect between heat shock to ethanol or between ethanol to oxidative stress, but protections almost never flow in the opposite direction. If we take a very mild oxidative stress and give it prior to an otherwise a very extreme heat shock that would kill, again, 1% of the population, it does not provide cross-protection. Okay. In fact, most of the strong protections are following the orders of events and not the reverse. And as you may have noticed, a very known phenomenon is autoprotection. A mild heat shock protects against an otherwise extreme heat shock, the same for ethanol, same for oxidative stress. So we returned back to the Pavlovian order of experiments and said, can we uncouple between the two responses? Can we, for instance, grow cells under a constant exposure to a high temperature and see if they would cut the connection to the oxidative stress. I can't show you because of interest of time, but we actually know which are the genes analogous to the mal operons that were known in advance. We have identified which are the genes that appear to manifest this effect. So let's do an evolutionary experiment. Grow them in heat shock constantly. I don't know if constant heat shock was a wise choice. Maybe we should have done it once a day or something, or a few times a day. Anyway, and see what happens to their oxidative response. Okay, let's see if we can do extinction here too. So how do you do this experiment? You take yeast cells and you evolve them under high temperature, and faithful to the idea of experimental evolution, we did it in four replicates. So four test tubes evolving under the same conditions. And again, faithful to the idea of experimental evolution, we did it with a control. A control means that you do the same experiment again in evolution, okay? Same conditions, same everything, same view treating them. Everything is the same, except that the temperature is mild and nice, 30 degrees as they like. Okay? And that's, again, in four repetitions. Yes?
I have a question.
Yeah.
What if organisms are more sensitive
to patterns in
the environment?
To what?
To some cues in the environment.
What if the two pathways here are trying to predict each other?
I mean, rather than predicting environment, what happens if you try to predict the behavior of predators? I mean, you're seeing the regularities of how the predator behaves.
Yeah, it's a good question. It's a different challenge. You know, in terms of the model that I've shown you, it might all boil down, perhaps, to knowing the value of this P here, right? If there is a predator and the predator makes a noise every time before it appears, but that noise could happen also without the predator appearing, that would affect the value of P. And as much as the model can capture this complexity, it boils down to something that is less exotic than a predator, just the value of P. I don't know to what extent else can you incorporate information about a predator that would make this consideration more tailored to this case.
I think the question is, what if the environment, or I think predator, could learn what the cell is doing now?
If the environment could learn what the cell is doing, okay. That's so your question was much more profound than I thought. That's beautiful. Let's think about it together. Yeah. Or two co-evolving species or something like that. Can they start to learn each other? So you learn each other better than I learned you. That's good. Okay. I don't know. It's a wonderful follow-up. So this is what we did. And we were hoping, since we knew, I didn't show you, you have to believe me or read the paper, we knew, or we thought we know, which are the genes that are responsible for the prior activation of the heat shock, of the oxidative stress genes due to heat shock. We were hoping that they will be repressed. And in order to see that, we looked at all the genes in the genome. We measured their expression level in the evolved cell. We call it EVO39 because it evolved under 39 degrees. And we compared their expression to the wild type. And we looked at the genes in a quite unconventional way. We simply arrayed all the genes according to the order along the chromosomes of the genome. We put one chromosome after the other. Who knows how many chromosomes Cerevisia has? 16. So we put here 16 chromosomes, and the genes are arranged in each chromosome according to the order along the chromosome. And it's in a log 2 space, so you see what's the relative expression of each gene in the evolved cell compared to the wild type. And some genes go down and some genes go up. We were hoping to see that all the genes of the conditioned response are going down, as much as you saw in the maltose, that after training them with lactose, no maltose, the maltose genes do not respond to lactose. This experiment was done under heat shock. And it's a long story, but it's going to take a very interesting turn to a totally different direction. I can tell you that some of these genes are indeed our genes, and they have been indeed repressed. But it's not the majority of those genes, but curiously, it's genes that are located on just a few of the chromosomes. Very interesting evolutionary dynamics of in chromosome biology going on here, but I will not tell you much about it, because as you see, something totally different jumps out of the picture in front of our eyes. And I deliberately tell the story in this way because this is not how we usually tell stories in papers. This is totally due to serendipity that this project took a totally different turn into a totally different and conditioning unrelated biology at all. So I'll switch now with you, but I want to show you A, that sometimes discoveries happen by serendipity, and that sometimes you are looking for one thing, but the gold is in a different location, you might want to follow it, even at the expense of abandoning another interesting project. Okay? What did we see? We see that there are many highly expressed genes in the mutant, but we colored in red all the genes on chromosome 3, one of the 16 chromosomes, and we saw that almost all of them are upregulated. How could that be? What on earth could upregulate almost all the genes on a particular chromosome? You see, by the way, that a few are not upregulated. What? So a duplication of the chromosome is immediately suggested. It's a diploid cell, it has two chromosomes. It actually goes almost precisely 50% up in expression. And although some genes appear to have resisted a change in the mRNA level in response to a change in the DNA level, perhaps this is what happened here. So we need to verify that. We did indeed. I'm not showing you that. It's in a paper. It's published. We did a DNA array as opposed to an mRNA array. And indeed, we saw very clearly, very nicely, that the chromosome 3 gained another copy in this evolution. I want to show you how each of the four replicates of the evolutionary experiments look like. It's the same type of display, the horizontal blue bars demarking the chromosomes. This is chromosome 3. It's one of the short chromosomes in the genome. And these are the four repetitions. And you see the red frame encompasses chromosome 3 in all repetitions. You see that in each case, chromosome 3 was duplicated. Again, there is DNA level support directly for that statement in each of those repetitions. You see that every now and then there is a local duplication. Incidentally, this duplication occurs twice. This one occurs only in one repetition. But the only thing that occurs in all four of them is the duplication of chromosome 3. That was interesting. But is it causal? Maybe it's just an epiphenomenon. And you can ask me, did it occur also in the 30 degree evolution? I can tell you it did not occur in the 30 degrees. Okay, we have a similar array done on the 30 degrees, didn't happen. So it appears to almost be necessary in some sense, well, very loose sense, but we can ask, is it sufficient? Is a third copy of chromosome 3 sufficient for withstanding the heat shock? So this is our evolved strain, and this is how much it can survive under heat shock. This is the wild type, it's defined at the level of 1, so three times more in the evolved strain. Then we took wild type, and we artificially supplemented it with another copy of chromosome 3. Okay? And you see it survives almost as the evolved strain, indicating that maybe necessary, for sure sufficient, to sustain a heat shock to the same level that the evolved strain sustains. By the way, if we generate a monosome of chromosome 3, namely one copy instead of two copies, and every event that would generate this will generate this in addition, because how do you get an additional chromosome? In normal mitosis, two chromosomes for each cell. In missegregation, one gets 3 and one gets 1. Okay? This is a very frequent event. We'll talk about the frequency of this event later. It occurs in a probability of maybe 10 to the minus 5 per division. Okay? So we see some dependence of heat response on copy number of chromosome 3. Then we said, let's play further. Let's take these cells, one of the lineages, and put them back under 30 degrees. What would happen if we evolve them in 30 degrees? It's not fun to have another copy of a chromosome. In humans, it's even detrimental at the level of the organism. Not, by the way, at the level of individual cells. Cancer, for instance, love to have extra copies of chromosomes. So chromosome aneuploidy, unequal proportion of all chromosomes, is very deleterious at an organismal level, not necessarily at the cellular level, but as we'll see, it's not pleasant even for a single-celled yeast organism to have another copy of chromosome 3, and if there is no pressure, they immediately lose that chromosome. This is their ancestor that had an extra copy of chromosome 3. We did the experiment in four repeats, and after some 400 generations, they flatten out totally the signal. So in all repetitions, apparently in all cells or most of the cells, the extra copy of the chromosome was lost. And with the loss of the chromosome was the loss of the capacity to withstand heat. So they forget the lesson very quickly when they don't need it. But perhaps a more interesting experiment is to keep pressuring them. Why don't we take those cells and rather than put them under 30, keep them for 1,000 or more than 1,000 generations under heat shock? Then they are facing with a more interesting dilemma, because the chromosome is protecting, but it has a burden. And can they find perhaps a better solution? Can they do something about it? So we did that in four repetitions also. I'm not going into the details. It turns out, if we start from this, and we follow, this is just a blow up on chromosome 3. We follow them under 450 generations, 1700 generation, 2300 generations. They gradually lose the chromosome starting from this ancestor or starting from this ancestor, and there are two additional ancestors that we had. So they gradually lose the chromosome. In fact, measuring mRNA abundance allows you to measure the proportion of the population that has the extra copy of the chromosome, assuming that there is still a proportionality between mRNA and DNA kept throughout. So we see a gradual loss in the population, we see the evolutionary dynamics, gradual loss of the chromosome. So, do they still withstand heat? Yes. Good, good, good question. We did hear DNA array, and we know that the chromosome is lost. Yes. This is, again, a blow-up on each of the four repeats on just chromosome 3. Each dot is a gene. You can now see the genes in the higher magnification, quote-unquote. And their level of expression relative to their ancestor that had three repeats is shown here. Sorry, relative to the original ancestor that had a normal copy number of just two. So it's in log space, so zero means just back to the disomic situation, two copies. You see that indeed they return back to the base level for most of the genes, but there is quite a span. Okay? And in particular, the red genes remained high in each of their repeats. And it's a little hard to see, but please believe me, the red genes are almost exactly the same in all four repeats. So chromosome 3 has, I think, 200 or 300 genes on it, and some 20 of the genes are red in almost every repeat of the experiment. So somehow, miraculously, it's still a miracle for us, the organism found a way to get rid of the chromosome that has a lot of burden and still maintain a few genes at high level. We could actually show that the red genes, if inserted into the organism, into the wild type, in an additional copy on a plasmid, they sustain a high resistance to heat, but the black genes that return to the base level do not do that. So we think that, yes?
So the evolved species, which got rid of the delta of the chromosome, it is still as good heat resistant as the three chromosome changes.
It doesn't only have a good heat resistance, it has an even better heat resistance. This is one. Now I'll tell you a few things about these strains. And I'll try to be quick because I want to tell you about new stuff. First, they withstand heat better than the trisomic strain. Second, they withstand, they are doing much better on normal temperature, to the extent that we think that if we now put them on normal temperature and let them evolve, they might not lose the solution because they have a smart and not very costly solution. This is what this graph is showing, but I'm skipping it. They are very happy also at 30 degrees. The solution is not such that remain that keeps them handicapped on 30 degrees. And they appear to be enjoying the best of all worlds. Now, there is a very interesting dilemma, an evolutionary dynamics dilemma of what happened first. Think about it. Did they first lose the chromosome and then gain those adaptations? Or did they gain the adaptations and then lost the chromosome? Each of them poses very interesting population dynamics riddles that we are trying to solve mathematically together with Martin Nowak and others. It is not very clear how could they coordinate and orchestrate those two adaptations. Yes?
Seems like it's a transposon kind of thing. And then you can just take out those parts of the thing and just get rid of the...
That could be interesting. That could be interesting. Yeah, maybe we should think about it together. In terms of DNA copy number, it does not appear as if those red genes are necessarily gaining an extra copy. Although I'm not sure about that, I think that this is a transcriptional response, but maybe it's a DNA-based response. Yeah, very good. Yes?
So, have you tried, like, if these genes, or like one of these four genes that you say are always in high, which show high mRNA levels, if they're externally provided, if they have the same stability in heat, high heat conditions?
If the genes themselves, if the RNAs have thermal stability?
Yes, my question is if it is a property of the gene or the property of the chromosome to behave in this manner.
That's a very good question. We have sequenced many of these genomes. We find mutations. There are no mutations that occur in the genome in the stage of the trisomy. Okay, the trisomy appears to really be a sufficient solution. But mutations do come in at the stage of what we call the refinement, the stage in which they throw the chromosome and just find a way to upregulate a few of the genes. Those mutations are not many of them, 10 or so per lineage, and they do not occur specifically in the red genes themselves. So I don't think that genetically, at least, there was a hard-coded change in the heat stability of the RNAs of the red genes. Okay, it appears as if something happened there at a transcriptional level, but we are still struggling to understand exactly what happened. I will show you an example where we understand exactly what happened, as time permits, but in a different experiment. We also did another experiment. We said rather than abruptly moving them from 30 degrees to 39 degrees, can we gradually heat it up so they start blue and gradually become red? Every week, we increase the temperature by 1 centigrade. Okay? Finally reaching to 39 and then keeping them at 39 for a while. You know what happened? They never duplicated the chromosome. Apparently, when the temperature increase is always one degree, the cost to benefit from duplication of a chromosome never justified, quote unquote, a duplication of a chromosome. Instead, they do have a set of point mutations that are scattered throughout the genome. Again, we don't understand exactly how those mutations support the heat survival, but I can tell you two things about those strains. A is that they do better at 30 degrees. B is that they do better than the trisomic cells on 30 degrees, again suggesting that we have obtained here a durable solution, a solution that even if put away from the pressure might still be sustained at least for a while because it's not very costly. It is based on just a few genes undergoing a change. There's much more to tell about it, but I'm not getting into it. I want to tell you, though, that we did the same type of experiment on a different stress. Perhaps the two most physical parameters in the environment of an organism are the temperature and the pH, right? So we evolved cells under high pH, did the same experiment, got essentially the same thing, except that it was not chromosome 3, but chromosome 5 that was duplicated. Each time we did the experiment, chromosome 5 was duplicated, returned back to normal pH, they lose the chromosome, keep them further at high pH, they will eliminate the chromosome and refine a solution again that is more durable, presumably. Okay, so there appears to be some, it's hard to generalize from two, but there appears to be some regularity here going on. Perhaps the organism is relying on the high prevalence of chromosome missegregation. The probability of missegregation is much higher than point mutation. Point mutation is maybe 10^-9, I don't know, after repair. Chromosome missegregation is 10^-5 per cell doubling. Okay, perhaps divide by 16 per chromosome, because there are 16 chromosomes, still orders of magnitude more. In fact, in the test tube, at the beginning of each experiment, if we have 1 million cells going into 100 million cells, even at the beginning, we have lots of trisomies from every chromosome. Evolution simply needs to select the right trisomy in the right condition. Yes, you had a question? Later? So this appears to be an interesting evolutionary strategy. Duplicate a chromosome for a while. This is a good solution. And then, as time goes by, try to refine it. So it was worthwhile taking this serendipitous discovery. I remind you, we came to it hoping to get an extinction of a conditioned response between heat shock and oxidative stress that wild-type yeast we thought have because of the process of wine production, et cetera, et cetera. But then we found something about aneuploidy and we just decided to follow it, and this is where it took us. So maybe it's a good lesson for students that sometimes you should not be, you know, locked on an original question if something interesting comes out. And what we learned from it is about the intermediates in an evolutionary adaptation. In particular, you start from two genome, there is an intermediate, it provides a quick and dirty solution, if you will. But with further time, a better solution could be found that is modified. There is this star here that is not present here. So back to normal karyotype, but with point mutations. But if you don't know the intermediate, you're missing the whole story. And I can tell you that this has inspired people that looked into pathogenic yeast, Candida albicans. It generates all sorts of infections in humans, and there is antibiotics that is given in hospitals in the treatment, and there is a resistance to the antibiotics, a gene for resistance, and if you trigger the cells, Candida albicans with the antibiotics, Judith Berman have discovered that they immediately duplicate a chromosome that bears that single gene. But it turns out that if you follow patients over long periods of time, Aviv Regev found out that they later eliminate a chromosome and still keep the resistance. So what we found here in the lab appears to have been relevant to dynamics, evolutionary dynamics, that you can also see even in a hospital. Okay, in the little time that I have, I think I will. Remember I told you, I'll tell you very briefly about that. Remember I told you in the previous lecture about the trend. Okay, sorry, pause. Not only our cells evolve, we evolve too in the lab. So we are evolving in those evolutionary experiments in three different phases. Okay, first phase that we are still enjoying is a phase in which we are changing the physiological parameters of the environment. Maltose, lactose, heat shock, whatever, pH, et cetera, et cetera. Very interesting. Second phase, we change their genetics. Okay, we trigger the cells with a genetic perturbation. I'll show you two types of them, and we see what happens. Third phase is exciting me very much, because in the third phase, we are asking a meta question. A question about which genes confer the capacity to evolve? What are the evolvability mechanisms of the genome? Evolution either towards challenges of the first or the second, physiological or genetic challenge. Okay, I'll try in the 20 minutes that I have to show you a glimpse about on each of them. So let's challenge the cells genetically this time and see what happens. As you know, we are very interested in translation and in the economy of translation and supply to demand relationships. If you remember, I've shown you that in cancer, supply and demand are, actually in normal cells too, supply and demand are very interestingly and tightly coordinated with one another. Cancer shifts a gear of the car from one state into another, but it appears to do that in a way that would still provide sustained supply and demand relationships within tRNAs and mRNAs and codons, et cetera, et cetera. We wanted to take that into the evolutionary regime too. So we took yeast cells and we deleted the tRNA that is present in zero copies in one copies in the genome. So now after we delete it, no copies at all. The cells are very poor, but they are not dying. We know why they are not dying. There is another tRNA with a different anticodon that provides a backup, and they live on that backup. But they are very poor. This is a growth curve. OD is a function of time. This is wild type. This is the tRNA delete mutant. As you see, it suffers quite a bit. But if we evolve that strain in the lab, after 200 generations, it's perfectly happy. Okay? There's no way it could resurrect that tRNA gene. It must have been doing something else. And at first, we thought that it's an epigenetic adaptation. And I want to point your attention to a recent paper from a month ago that we had in Cell by Yona et al., in which we actually delineate the spectrum from physiological, epigenetic, and genetic adaptations. We thought that this is an epigenetic adaptation that gave rise to it. But it turned out to be an hard-coded genetic adaptation, a single nucleotide that changed in the genome, and that conferred that solution, that provided that solution. I will not tell you what that single nucleotide adaptation is. It is published in a paper in eLife by Yona et al. Again. But I don't tell you that because we didn't know what was the solution, and we actually could guess it. And we sequenced that just that gene, and we found the mutation that we expected. So I want you to think by yourselves, what could be a genetic solution to that tRNA deletion mutation? And I can tell you that we have indeed observed such a mutation. We could put it back in the background of the deleted genome and so that it totally recovers the fitness. So that was an easy case. That was a case, it was easy for us. Maybe we understand that system better. We did an experiment, the cells did one mutation, and that mutation is sufficient, and we could actually predict it in advance and actually recapitulate the effect of this mutation. So that was encouraging, almost generated some hubris among us. But to humble us, we are looking now on a more challenging for us, genetic perturbation. And the genetic perturbation that we are playing with now is back again in E. coli. We want to ask the question, how does, and it relates very much to Professor Scott's beautiful talks about, beautiful lectures about the relationships between growth rate and expression level, etc. We wanted to ask, and an unneeded gene that only provides a burden to the cell. We wanted to ask, if we put an unneeded gene, and that is going to be GFP, within a cell, within E. coli, but that it is expressed to various levels because it has a different promoter or a different ribosome binding site or a different set of codons, as I've shown you, it's important, or a different secondary structure of the RNA, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. We want to see how does expression level of that gene affects the fitness, but perhaps going beyond the relationships between expression and fitness, we want to see if there are sequence designs that allow you to express the gene to a certain level and not suffer as much as otherwise would have been predicted. Can you be smarter and release or relieve some of the costs and expenses while still expressing the gene at high level. I'm going to be very brief about it. So we are going to rely here, we are relying here on a library that George Church and colleagues have synthesized. A library is a collection of genes in which GFP is regulated by is tagged here by a segment of 11 amino acids, a variable region taken from genes in the genome, and upstream to it there is a ribosome binding site to control translation, and further upstream there is a promoter, and the promoter comes from two types, and the ribosome binding site comes from four types, and there are many hundreds of versions of that leader sequence here, and all in front of the same GFP, so they push that GFP to various levels of expression. Okay? If you take a collection of cells, each of which is expressing one of 14,000 different versions, it's a huge combinatorial library, 14,000 different clones, each with a unique sequence. If you put them through a fax machine, it will sort them according to fluorescence level. You can sequence each bin and ask each sequence, what level of expression does it confer upon the cell? Okay? Now, we wanted to do an evolutionary experiment. So we took E. coli cells and we transfected them with a collection of those plasmids. Again, 40,000 different plasmids. So some cells get a high expressors, some cells get lower expressors, etc., etc. The first thing that we wanted to know is to understand what's the relationship between the fitness of the cell that expresses a gene to various levels. And we wanted to separate the cells according to their fitness. How do you separate cells according to fitness? You can simply do a competition. Okay? Time will tell them apart. Indeed, pictorially at least, you can imagine that you start with a very complex mixture of 14,000 strains with some relatively equal proportions, and as time goes by, perhaps just a few tycoons, as we call them, take over. Okay? How do we know? We barcode each sample, each time point along the evolution. It took about a month. Every 4 days, we take an aliquot. We barcode them for sequencing. We pull them all together and we sequence in one go. In fact, we did that experiment in six repetitions and seven time points, so 42 different barcodes. It's a very interesting genomics exercise. You read 200 million reads that more or less split evenly between the 42 types of collections. And for each of them, you get to see what's the prevalence of each one of the 14,000 strains. And you might see that some take over and others disappear, etc., etc. It's an infinitely interesting set of data. They begin to undergo mutations, and the mutations are interesting. I can't describe it all now. When we plotted, pretty much like Matthew told us, the relationship between fitness, this is the reciprocal of their doubling time, deduced from number of read counts, versus, for some reason, the logarithm of protein expression level, the GFP, that was measured originally by George Church. We still have to measure expression during evolution. We haven't done that. So we are, in a way, assuming that GFP did not change, but this is a problematic assumption. We nonetheless see that there is a whole region, but this is a logarithmic scale, so it is misleading. There is a small region of expression in which there is little dependency of fitness on expression. And then, again, on a logarithmic scale, there appears to be a decline here. That's interesting. We are trying to understand that to see if it fits with the Scott model or perhaps with other models. There were interesting discussions about that. I'm trying to recruit help. In fact, if you draw this on a linear scale, it's actually a straight line more than anything else. And that would fit, I think, with your model, at least qualitatively. I don't know. The other direction that we are taking it, and I'm only hinting about it because I want to tell you something about the neglected father of Darwin at the end, is that look at this design. This is a sequence that is present in front of the same GFP that everyone else has, but each dot is a different sequence. There's supposed to be 14,000 dots here. So this is a particular design that was able to sustain high fitness despite being very highly expressed. This design is expressed to the same level, but is very, very poor. So this definitely deviates from the general scaling of fitness with expression. You see, there is in fact a huge span of values at each level of expression value. So we believe that is a very interesting secret that these guys know, and we would love to know as well. We call that secret, how do you do more for less? How do you produce a protein to a high level and don't pay the price? Okay? And again, time does not allow me to say much about it, but I think that we are beginning to understand what are some cost factors in addition to just allocating ribosomes, for instance, to a gene. What are additional cost factors? We simulate the movement of ribosome on each of those designs as dictated by their sequence. And we reveal various components. We actually have now a machine learning model that predicts this fitness residual, as we call it, the difference between the expected fitness and the actual fitness based on sequence. So we begin to appreciate how can you, for instance, allocate ribosomes efficiently to the mRNA so they don't jump into each other, etc., in order to allow you to express highly and still don't pay the price. In the last few minutes, I want to talk into a future current direction that we play with, and that's the third phase of our evolutionary experiments in the lab. And as I said, we're going to ask here a meta question. The meta question is not how do you evolve towards a tRNA deletion or a maltose or a lactose or whatever. The meta question is which genes confer that ability? Or in other words, what are the evolvability mechanisms of the genome? Okay, it's an interesting question. I always say that I have an iPhone 5S. Okay? It's a nice machine. It can do lots of things. There's one thing that it cannot do. You know what it is? What? It cannot become iPhone 6. Okay? Is that a coincidence? No, it's not, because Apple wants me to buy in a year time iPhone 6. So even if they could design an evolution chip in the iPhone, they wouldn't put it in my iPhone and not in yours. Right? How could you design an evolvability chip for an iPhone? What would you do if you were an electrical engineer and you want to embed within the iPhone 5S the capacity to upgrade itself to become an iPhone 6? I don't know, maybe acquire information from the environment, do sex with other iPhones, I don't know what. We want to find those evolvability genes. Okay? We want to find the evolvability genes of the genome. And we started, so what is an what's the functional definition of an evolvability gene? Let's say that this is the wild type, and this is a curve of fitness over time. You evolve it over a long time, and the fitness improves because it's not an iPhone 5. It does evolve. But maybe if gene number 2 is an evolvability gene that naturally occurs in the genome, and you have deleted that gene, the organism cannot evolve. So let's try to see if we can find deletion mutants that, when facing with, lactose followed by maltose, and we're facing with high pH or low pH, whatever, the organism simply cannot evolve as much as the wild type can. Maybe there are genes that are doing that the organism evolves better without them. Why have those genes? Why does the organism need genes that limit its evolvability capacity. I don't know that there are such genes. Actually, I think I do know. I haven't shown you. But why would the organism have such genes that limit the evolvability capacity? You know, explorations have a cost. We talked among us about exploration, exploitation. There is a trade-off between them. Okay? You are here, you are coming to explore, but you are away from your lab. You're not, or your desktop, or whatever it is. You're not exploiting other resources that you already have because you are hoping to get something new. So there needs to be a balance between how much you explore and how much you exploit, and there should be genes that would be exploration genes, but there might be genes that would be, I don't know, robustness genes or cooling down genes. If we delete them, maybe the organism would evolve faster. Maybe it will pay the price later on. Okay? And working in yeast, we don't only have a deletion library, we have an overexpression library. So mutant 1 could have been overexpressing gene number 1. Okay? I want to show you, who is our neglected grandfather? Lamarck. You know about Lamarck, right? I didn't neglect him. I think that the most important, to me at least, development in understanding of evolution of the last decade is the realization that Lamarck was not that awfully wrong. Okay? Look at papers by people such as Oli Rando and Oded Rehavi, my friend and colleague, and you'll see Lamarckism in action even in mammals. Okay? Oli Rando did an experiment in which he starved mice, males, to protein, and their progenies, F1 progenies, their immediate children, had modified liver metabolism phenotypes. What is that if not Lamarckism? Are the Lamarckian evolution genes in our genome? They would be perhaps evolvability genes. With and without them, the rate at which organism evolves could be different. We ask that question also formally. We ask, what if you take a genetic algorithm, which I think you know about, and add to it a capacity that normal genetic algorithms don't have, a Lamarckian capacity? What is the essence of Lamarckian capacity? That information also flows from the phenotype back into the genotype so it can be inherited, or maybe only to the epigenotype. But at least it doesn't stay only with the phenotype because the phenotype is short-lived. So what could be a mechanism, a molecular mechanism, a gene, an actual gene that converts, reverses information backwards into the genome? I almost spelled it out. Reverse transcription can, perhaps, might do that. Reverse transcription takes the expressed information in the CD and returns it back into the CD. Right? Imagine that you were playing the music from a CD, very anachronistic, and you were singing along with it, and your sing-along would have been burned back into the CD. This is what reverse transcription does. It has the capacity to take interesting changes that the RNA experienced and return them back into the genome. RNA is very, very dynamic compared to the DNA. It's dynamic because copy number of transcripts change according to temperature, etc., etc. And the error rate, if in DNA it was 10 to the minus 9th, the error rate in synthesis of RNA nucleotides is probably 10 to the minus 3 or 4. So maybe a million times higher. So when an organism faces, for instance, a heat shock, the heat shock genes, the heat shock RNAs, they have a solution that the genome doesn't know. Just by the fact that they are highly expressed, they know something, and maybe we want to give it to the next generation, and they are mutating very rapidly. So we are trying to understand from a more theoretical point of view, a population dynamics point of view, does it help an organism that has such arrow that points back from the phenotype. The transcriptome is a phenotype already, back into the genotype. Okay, so we are playing with that, and we realized maybe your methods to detect activity of processes could be helpful for us. Let me, I think, stop here and just acknowledge the people who did all this work and take your questions. This is a fantasy, but the fantasy has some lines of support. I can tell you more about that. Very, very, very preliminary support at the level of initial feasibility. I just say it because I don't want you to get the wrong impression. It turns out that the reverse transcription reaction both occurs, by the way, also in cancer. Very interesting. Cancer also evolves. And the reverse transcription reaction occurs in a particular organelle that the element builds. And within that element, you can actually find the genome's genes. Okay, so we are trying to deepen into that and see what happens. Yes, presumably. In cancer, for instance, we and others have seen that there are certain genes in certain cancers, not too many of them, that appear in additional copy in the genome. This looks a bit like the transposition event, except that this is retrotransposition event. How do we know that this must have been due to retrotransposition, namely transcription and then reverse transcription and then integration into the DNA, as opposed to the DNA transposition? You know how? Because we look at the gene that normally appears in the genome with introns, and then we see it elsewhere in the genome without introns. It's only transcription that could have taken away those introns. It's inconceivable that the DNA transposition would only take the exons. Okay? So I think that cancer might be evolving Lamarckianly in that respect, taking RNAs that produced, maybe did something good, maybe not, I don't know, and put them back, perhaps in addition, perhaps it overwrites the original gene. These things have mechanisms not only to overwrite, but to insert themselves in new places. And what is that if not Lamarckian evolution? Yeah, that's very interesting. So I think that a previous talk in the morning alluded to that trade-off between exploration and exploitation. I think that Tom showed us very nicely that cells in the middle of the colony that are being starved are more towards exploration. They start to play with their mobile elements, whereas cells in the periphery of the thing that maybe are just exploiting. They don't need to explore because they are healthy and they have good food, etc. So maybe you can claim that along a radial axis from the middle of the colony to the periphery, the trade-off between exploration and exploitation is modified. I don't know. Maybe it's a good system to quantify that trade-off. There are other systems to do that. For instance, you also mentioned horizontal gene transfer, which need not necessarily involve sex between two bacteria. It could be just uptake of foreign DNA that from dead cells that is in the environment. So Bacillus subtilis, for instance, that has such a mechanism to uptake foreign DNA, would not activate it if it's perfectly happy. When it's perfectly happy, there's good food, et cetera, it will not explore, it will exploit. But starve it, and it will start to explore. E. coli has two DNA polymerases, at least two. I'm not sure exactly. Maybe you know better. One with high error rate, one with low error rate. Guess which one is used in stress conditions. So I think we see that... and by the way, in your first talk and in Pankaj's talk, so Pankaj, you remember he had that error rate of the ribosome, it was F naught to the Lth power, right? The Lth power can be substantial. He showed us a case of the T cell receptor in which, what was the value of L, do you remember? Maybe 5, maybe 3. So they invest a lot in ensuring that they don't do mistakes, right? So that is exploitation in some sense. But they don't invest even further. They don't take L to the 7th power. Maybe it has to do with some expectation about the benefit of exploration. Maybe the L, the value of L, is another way to play on the scale of exploration exploitation. A very low L, you're explorative, okay? Maybe that your tendency to explore depends on the probability you mentioned that we don't know yet. What's the probability of beneficial mutation? What's the fraction of the deleterious mutations? If the organism knows that, if beneficial mutations are very highly prevalent, maybe it's good to explore, keep L at low value. I'm over simplifying, but that L could be another interesting axis. Absolutely. I think that the last resistance to Lamarckism was dissolved when CRISPR was discovered. Okay? What happens in CRISPR, just like in horizontal gene transfer, by the way, what happens in CRISPR is that your environment becomes your genotype. As simple as that. So I just feel regret for Lamarck that he didn't live to see CRISPR.
Would you say that sometimes evolution acts on the community scale?
You're entering a battlefield. if you read Richard Dawkins' The Selfish Gene, you would see.
Simple system as bacterial colonies.
No, I'm not saying that I'm objecting what you're saying. I might be supporting what you're saying. I'm just saying that evolutionary theorists speak about three different levels at which evolution could act. It could be the society, maybe even above the species, a society. Maybe, I don't know, maybe monkeys and cows could co-evolve together and could be the subject of evolution. It could be the individual, you, me. And Richard Dawkins would say it's neither the above, neither the society or the collection, nor the individual, but the gene, the selfish gene. When we saw interesting examples for selfish genes today, it's the selfish gene that is the action, that is the target of selection. And according to Dawkins, you cannot justify selection acting at any other level above the level of selfish gene. But I don't necessarily agree with him. You might be right, and I think it's interesting to look for justifications for selection happening at the level of populations. Dawkins thinks that logically he proved that this is impossible, but I don't necessarily buy it. Okay, thank you. I'm leaving soon, so it's been wonderful to be with you for this week. I think you're an amazing young generation of very smart, very curious, very excellent scientists. You'll do great. I look forward to being in touch with you.
So maybe we have one round of applause for all the speakers of the school. I think it's been a wonderful thing. And I'm getting a lot of responses from